May I request, since Mr. Manu Singh, Manu Shivastav and also Gaurav Sood are here, may I request both of them to join us on the dais, please? Thank you. So, Pinakil, you can.
So, I will just keep it short. So, primarily, I will explain you our story and the sectors that we have sort of played till now and what are the implications and what are our suggestions on those three sectors. So, AMP is sort of a global IPP, and our business is to provide dispatchable clean energy. So, in North America, we are focusing on that. That is providing dispatchable clean energy through storage, a mix of wind and solar. In case of Japan, it is mainly a utility business where we are selling power to the utilities. In Australia, it is primarily merchant power business. And in India, we have established a full triple play. So as a triple play, what we mean is that we are not a CNI only company, we are a CNI focused company. However, when we established operations here in India, we took the learnings out of our prior experience of having established a couple of gigawatt scale IPPs to do it right the first time. So we thought that the barrier to entry is higher in case of the CNI sector. So that's where we focused, and the barrier to entry in case of the utility is much lower because primarily it is mainly driven by bidding. So as of today, out of the entire 2 gigawatt late stage pipeline that IMP has, and a 1,000 megawatt portfolio in terms of operating construction and development assets, we are having around 450 megawatts. We have been keeping a very low profile because all these 450 megawatts have been self-developed. Not a single project we basically went out there and bid and got the thing, because that we thought is a different business strategy. So we are trying to create a sustainable platform. And now that the government change is going to happen and there will be slightly more stability in terms of the duty structure and the pricing on the utility side, we will also start looking at that side to balance the portfolio. But if I talk briefly about the three sectors, on the CNI open access, the issue remains that there's an opportunity, which is that a lot of corporates are actually buying large volumes of power. They are willing to put in actually equity stakes in the project, which is a good thing. However, the policy certainty is something that we have to watch out for, and that depends from state to state. So that is something that actually needs to be worked out so that this thing can grow faster. As far as the distributed generation sector is concerned, the main issue there remains the financing. Because the speed at which the financing happens is not in sync with the pace at which the projects have to be delivered. So there have been these lines from World Bank and ADB and all, but it's faster for me to sort of get a 75 to 100 megawatt project financed than to get a 1 megawatt project financed, so which is not in line with the objectives of those lines. So that has to be seriously looked at, but because on the customer side, our distributed generation is a limitless opportunity. It just makes business sense pretty much everywhere. It's not too much driven by the policy there. The third sector in utility scale, I would say main issue that we have been facing is one is that this bids getting announced and then getting cancelled. So people sort of, you basically block a lot of funds in these guarantees and all, and that is not a good thing. And that has restricted players like us to go out and bid at this point in time. So these are the three observations of the three sectors that we are playing.
Thank you. So before we go on, may I request Manush Shivastavji and Gaurav Sood to introduce yourself. A lot of people in this hall and outside, of course, know both of you as celebrities, but for the sake of the format getting completed, may I request you both to introduce yourself. Manoj.
Thank you. I am working in Madhya Pradesh. I look after the new and renewable energy department in Madhya Pradesh. I have also now been looking after the commercial tax department, but I think that's outside the pale of this room. The projects that are interesting that we have tried to implement are One is Riva, Gaurav is sitting next to me, one of the three developers who are developing the Riva project. Riva is a 750 megawatt project. It has the distinction of being the first project which with which the solar tariff became lower than that of coal-based power. Earlier, the system we had was that we used to have viability gap funding-based projects, and the target tariff was 4 rupees 50 paisa. We attempted to de-risk the project and to have an appropriate risk allocation between the developer, procurer, and us. And hopefully, because of those reasons and also other reasons, we got an extremely competitive tariff. From that project, we are also supplying power. It's only the first case, and actually till now the only case, in which power from the project is being supplied to an institutional open access customer. So we would be supplying power to, we are supplying power rather to Delhi Metro. The change in verb is relevant because we have started supplying power from today. So if I was speaking yesterday, I should have said we would be supplying power. And today I can say we are supplying power. So Gaurav, I will not be, but Gaurav is supplying power, and other developers starting today morning have started supplying power to Delhi Metro. And so we can say that Delhi Metro is running with power from Madhya Pradesh. We are actually also having an International Solar Alliance DG, and I will be traveling on the Delhi Metro today as a symbolic thing today around 4:15 p.m. for the same reason. Another project that we have done, is interesting project, has been the rooftop RESCO project, where we attempted a lot of aggregation of government buildings. And there also we tried to develop the project documents, which so that there was sufficient de-risking and also appropriate risk allocation. So because of that, we achieved the landmark low tariff of 1.38 rupees for rooftop projects. So that has been a huge attraction to largely government buildings in Madhya Pradesh. It's extremely low tariff. And now in the same line, we are coming up for a RESCO project for industries, around 40 megawatt rooftop or industries in Mandi Deep area next to Bhopal. So that is something that we are doing right now. So we should expect the results in another 1.5, 2 months.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Gaurav Sood. I'm the CEO of Spring Energy, which is a renewable platform started around 2 years back. It is fully funded by Actis Private Equity Fund. We have a commitment of around $500 million of equity. We are doing both solar and wind projects out of this platform. I think when we started in 2 years, fortunately the market has been very good in general in terms of the tenders being floated by central government. And over a period of 2 years, we have built almost a 1.65 gigawatt pipeline, out of which we have 50-50 between solar and wind. We already have about 450 megawatt solar operating capacity, out of which 200 megawatt is in the Riva solar park. And we would be commissioning the remaining capacity later this month. So our first fully commissioned project, the 250 megawatt Riva, would be done. We have it has been a very exciting journey for us. We in our platform has some of the lowest tariffs, 2.43 on the wind side. Even on solar, all these tariffs are very very competitive. Starting with Riva, with our Anandpur solar park as well as our Kadapa solar park. And now we are looking to further add more solar and wind capacity as we move forward. And that's how we have gone ahead in Anandpur and Kadapa solar parks also, with two more winds, 250 megawatt each. Generally, if we look at the sector today, it's good. There is a very strong push for the tenders, but at the same time, there are a lot of challenges which are there. We all know that payment of these tariffs is very important. All developers have been bidding at very competitive tariffs. So it is important to see how do we get these timely payments happening. For example, in Riva, we are rebate is being taken every month and we are getting paid. So it's a great, it really helps. But in other state discoms and other tenders, if these payments are delayed, since the financial models today are stretched, so we have to make sure that these are paid in time. Also, a lot of the bids are happening with central government, with SECI or NTPC as the off-taker. I think that also is very important that we ensure that they are, you know, their balance sheet is available to IPPs in case of any non-payments. Otherwise, if it is a pure back-to-back, then it is a concern for the investors, because today we as investors and lenders and the entire community draws a lot of comfort from intermediaries like NTPC and SECI, being like sovereign entities at the end of the day. So we need to ensure that the PPAs and as well as the power sale agreements are structured in the same manner. Also, I'm going to say we are seeing a new trend where both NTPC, SECI, and various state DISCOMs have started saying that the PPAs are valid only once the tariffs are adopted by the respective regulatory commissions. I think this is especially when tariffs are bid out, are worked out of competitive bidding process. This is more of a procedural matter, and respective commissions need to adopt these tariffs in time. Otherwise, it delays the projects and drags the equity return of investors. Apart from that, in general, I would say evacuation is still a concern, especially the ISTS network. The timeline taken to build the networks and the availability of these networks in time for commissioning the project within timelines is very critical, and hence a lot of focus is required on this front. I think these are some of the key challenges how I see about this sector. Otherwise, I think we are all fortunate as players to be in this sector. It is very competitive, but at the same time provides a very large canvas for every player to contribute and towards the journey which our government has set forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Gaurav. I was taking my notes actually all the while you were speaking, of course. So I think a lot of challenges, and before I say something myself, I would actually like to have the benefit of some of the solutions that Sanjeev Agarwal has structured already. And he's here to share his success story and success mantra with all of you. I would like to invite him to make his special comments on this. And he has to leave early, so I'm requesting him to speak before I do.
Yes, I think many of you may be aware of M-Plus Solar. And M-Plus is, I think, a homegrown. Now getting into international markets, already we are working in many markets. So I think it's a matter of great pride for us as a team to develop what we have done. Right from starting from a 100 kilowatt plant in 2014, and today in 2019, we are close to 500 megawatt of operational under construction capacity. And you say it's a reasonably tough sector to work only in the C&I space, because our average project size is like 300 kilowatt when we work on the rooftops. Of course, there are open access projects as well in this portfolio. But generally, we have to deal with a very large number of customers. And so when we're dealing with all these customers, then when we're dealing with this set of 170 customers that we already have, it requires a bit of an effort, because what we are really doing is we are in a customer service industry. Actually, as a company, we don't look at ourselves as a solar company. We look at ourselves as a energy solutions or a services company, because I would say that is one of the key differentiators that we bring on the table when we talk to the customers. We don't try to sell them a solar project, we try to give them an energy solution. And what that creates is a significant differentiation when people are considering us as a solutions provider versus many other people. We remain completely open to understand what people's problems can be and how we can address that, because they are not from this industry. We can't impose a 25-year PPA on that. We can't impose a certain contract which is given in many of the, for example, the utility scales PPA. So there's a different mindset that we adopted from the beginning in terms of how we are going to deal with the customers. The second thing is, many of you might have also read in the newspapers recently, is that we have entered into an acquisition documentation with Petronas, which is a Malaysian oil and gas state-owned company. Very large company, it's a Fortune 200 company. And so they have a deep desire to get into the renewable space. What that means is that we get a reasonably large platform to work at, apart from India, in the international markets wherever Petronas is present and what else can be done. All this essentially goes on to prove that there is a large demand, and which is driven by the society at large, that we want to change as a society towards green energy. All the challenges that we are seeing today from the regulator side, from the distribution company side, are the signs of a changing industry. Because if we are trying to bring a change, there are going to be challenges from the incumbents. And we have to deal with those challenges as an industry. And the people who are actually creating these challenges, when we talk about net metering or the cross-subsidy or not getting the open access approvals, etc., these are people are trying to protect the turfs. So I don't know what the right set of solutions will be, because it's a complex industry from a socio-political perspective. We have to continue to find out what is the right solution which works for everyone, because the energy is such a basic necessity that the government just can't say, okay, do whatever you want to do in the industry and we make it like a free commodity. That's extremely unlikely. So when there is these new technologies coming up from the solar side, storage side, and all these are getting integrated into the larger grid with the customers, there are going to be challenges, and that means there are new opportunities for people to participate in various manners, whether it is coming from the technology side, energy efficiency side, demand aggregation side, or simply finding out what are the new solutions which should work for all the players in the sector. So it's going to be a more hybrid industry. There will be larger plants, there will be smaller distributed generation, and all that together has to make sense. So a lot of things yet to be done. I think we'll be seeing a complete transition over the next 10 to 20 years in the energy industry as we have known it for the last 100 years. I think that is my main comment on the challenge. So I hope that we have many more companies like M+, where there is a global interest and people recognize India as a leading market in the renewable space. And obviously we don't have the dearth of the management potential or management capability in the country. So Sanjeevji, thanks for calling me here.
Thanks for being here. I think before you rush out, I have one question which I thought I would be able to do it after everyone has spoken. But before you leave, maybe one thing which I would like you to share with everyone is one question that always come up when we meet everyone around in the industry. I'm sure Gaurav, all others will share this with me, that lot of people, lot of companies, CEOs have been grappling with getting investors to understand that, of course they're very bullish, all investors are bullish on Indian renewable energy space, the way it is growing, it is maturing up, larger deal sizes every day, and I think we are upping our targets and name whatever you. But one thing nobody's seeing is the exit, and typically realizing money off the table, taking money back home for investors is still a dream. IPOs have still remained very elusive, and companies have not really been able to grow So I would want that if you can share what you felt in this whole journey, what will be the key success strategy for attracting these investors, how you've been able to do it maybe.
Again, like, you know, in the renewable industry, what we have seen is that most of the platforms or most of the companies are largely private equity funded. Unlike the earlier scenario in the coal fire plant, there will be a lot of Indian promoter groups which were investing capital in this industry. Renewable industry has brought in a lot of foreign capital and the private equity capital. And the private equity, by their nature, by their very nature, they are investors and they will look for an exit. It goes without saying that what they are aiming is like the financial returns. Now, it's not very, sometimes I think, is it very different from an e-commerce industry? What we are trying to do in the renewable industry? Is it like getting more and more investors, making bigger and bigger size and creating very, very large companies? What is the ultimate game of all this? See, the final exit to my mind is only two, whether you have public markets or there are some strategic investors who will come and acquire these portfolios for the longer run. What we are seeing in the utility scale is that there are some of these pension funds, particularly the Canadian pension funds, which are reasonably interested in holding the assets for very, very long term. So this becomes a dividend income. So that is one set of investors who will be interested, long-term pension funds. The second will be possibly some successful IPOs, which we saw even in the thermal industry, which happened. And third is, like, there is a new, new interest from the oil and gas majors, whether this is a company like Petronas or Shell or Total or some other people who are still not here, Statoil, etc. So these people have interest because what people are also seeing that oil and gas industry has come to a completely mature level, and with the drop in the renewable industry and possibly with the addition of the storage in that, oil will have a limited value. At some stage, people may find that it's not even worthwhile to go for the exploration of new oil, because the exploration cost of the newer oil blocks may be even higher than what you can do renewable plus storage. So this becomes an additional avenue for these companies to get into this area. I think, though, ultimately, when we are looking at these set of investors, all these investors, what they want is a stable, well-run company, good assets, high level of corporate governance. So these are some of the factors which ultimately define.